Lion of Sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid.
Silent as he stood accused.
My salvation, where your love poured out over me, and now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Sent of now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me, whom the Son sets free. Oh, let's all sing that together. Now my debt.
Now my debt.
Stone is rolled away. Behold the empty tomb. Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah. God be praised. He's risen from the grave.
Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation. Where you
if you would remain standing, please. We're going to be in John chapter 20. So we're going to read the Word of God while we're standing, and then we'll get into it. If you have your Bibles, John chapter 20. Now, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Peter therefore went out and the other disciple and were going to the tomb. So they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. Now he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloths lying there, yet he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb, and he saw the linen cloths lying there and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed. For as yet he did not know the scripture, or they did not know the scripture, that he must rise again from the dead. Then the disciples went away again to their homes. Verse 11. But Mary stood outside by the tomb weeping, and as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. Then they said to him, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Now, when she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there and did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" She, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him, "Rabboni," which is to say, teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go to the brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father and my God and your God." Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord and that he had spoken these things to her. Verse 19, then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. So Jesus said to them again, "Peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Now Thomas, called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said to him, "We have seen the Lord." So he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the print of the nails and put my finger into the print of his nails and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." And after 8 days, his disciples were again inside and Thomas with them. Jesus came when the doors began shut and stood in the midst and said, "Peace to you." Then he said to Thomas, "Reach your finger here and look at my hands, and reach your hand here and put it into my side. Do not be unbelieving, but believing." And Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Thomas, because you have believed me, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Verse 30. And truly Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. Amen. Father, as we look to your word, Father, we want to hear what you have to say to us. Give us ears to hear what your spirit would say. And Lord, I pray for your spirit to work through me, that you would increase and I would decrease. We desire to hear from you, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may have a seat. The title of this message today is, "Do Not Be Unbelieving, But Believing." Do not be unbelieving, but believing. A.W. Tozer said, "What I believe about God is the most important thing about me." Think about that. What you believe about God is the most important thing about you. If you believe God is great and awesome and magnificent, it can do anything, you're going to live a life of faith, believing those promises and following after him and seeing great things. If your belief in God is small, he's not really that important, he doesn't really care about us, he just lets us do our own thing or whatever, you're not going to experience God. And Jesus is trying to get to his disciples to get them to believe, to not be unbelieving, but believing. I was thinking about this the other day, and I was thinking, and when our country started, one of the greatest men in America was George Washington. He was a leader. He was a man above men. He was like 6'3", 6'4", larger than life, but he had courage, he had bravery, he had character. He was the main guy that led our our country to have freedom. And he was the only president voted unanimous. Could you imagine a president being united, every single person? Not these days. Anyways, imagine you're one of his soldiers, and all of a sudden, you're in all these attacks and all these battles with the British. You're winning, you're losing, you're winning, you're losing, but you're starting to move forward, and all of a sudden, he gets killed. You would be devastated. You would be bummed out. You would be in tears. You would be so discouraged and so depressed because there was no one else like him who could step up and take his place. And you'd be scared to death because the British were coming. They were always coming, and now you don't have your great general to take care of him. Well, the only thing you can make that better is if he didn't die. And kind of like Jesus, they're in a situation where their hero, their champion, their Lord, their king, their master, their everything is dead. And man, they are bummed out. They are mourning. They are discouraged. They're down. It talks about how they were sad. It also says that they, for fear of the Jews, they were hiding inside. And so Jesus wants to get these guys to believe once again. And so we have this great story here in John 20. And I have 4 points if you're a note taker. They wondered, they wowed, they worshiped, and the word. They wondered, verse 1 through 10. They wowed, they were wowed in verse 11 to 27. They worshiped in verse 28 to 29. And the word in verse 30 to 31. It says in verse 1 that the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark. You know what? She had the same love for Jesus that Jesus had for the Father. Because in Mark 1:35, it talks about how Jesus rose a long while before daylight and went to a solitary place, and there he prayed. He sought the Lord early. And all of your greats seek the Lord early. You look in the Bible, you'll see Abraham rose early, Joshua rose early, Moses rose early, Hannah rose early. They rose early to meet the Lord and to worship and to start their day on the right path. And what a great thing to do to start early. But then while she's there, she sees the stone that had been rolled away, and there was an angel sitting on it. So this might be the original Rolling Stones. I don't know. I mean, just that was pretty lame. I don't know why I said that. Anyways, it says that she ran. Have you ever seen a woman run? Hold. Someone's going to get... Let me rephrase that. Yeah, they're in their little jogging suits out there running, but have you ever seen a woman like on a full sprint? Unless she's in the Olympics, no. But this woman ran. And it says in the other Gospels that she was running, and she ran quickly, and she had fear and joy at the same time. She sees a tomb empty. She's still putting it together, but she is running to tell the disciples, I got to bring them this great news. I don't know what the news is, but this is what the angel told me. And if the angel speaks to you, you kind of got to listen to the angel, right? So she runs and it says, he came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple. You know what? In one of the Gospels, when the angels told her and told the girls, or the women, because he sends the women and he also sends Mary Magdalene, and says, go tell the disciples and Peter. Peter needed a special word. We're going to talk about that next week. Because Peter's last recollection of the Lord was he denied him. And when you deny him the third time, it says that they made eye contact. And it says the Lord looked at him. And then Peter remembered what Jesus had told him. Before the rooster crows twice, you're going to deny me three times. And it says he went out and he wept bitterly. Peter needed a special word of encouragement. But as you're going to see in this story and next week, Jesus is big on reaching out to people collectively, but also individually. And so Peter comes to the tomb, and also John comes to the tomb, and a lot of jokes have been made about, you know, in verse 4, they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter, you know, because he wrote this. So he can say he outran him, you know. Kind of like you tell everybody how great your game of golf was when you beat your friend and actually throw the score down to people. It's like, whatever. But what happens is they get there, and it says that John, stooping down in verse 4, looking in, he saw the linen cloths lying, but he did not go in. Then Peter came, and he followed him, and he actually went into the tomb, and he saw the linen cloths also, and the handkerchief lying around his head and folded together. And then verse 8 says, then the other disciple, which would be John, who came to the tomb first, he had to put that in there again, by the way, went in also, and he saw and believed. Isn't that amazing? You get two guys. They both walk with the Lord for three and a half years. They're his top guys, the top disciples. They both see the same thing. They're both stooping down. They're both like kind of wondering. And then John believes, but Peter, we don't see him believing yet. And we all kind of come to faith a little bit different. Our timing isn't the same as someone else's timing. But God doesn't mind if you ask questions. It says in Isaiah, come, let us reason together. You know, God wants you to come to him with this question. Just come to him, though, you know? And so he's just deciding all this. And then we read in verse 9, for as yet they did not know the scriptures that he must rise again from the dead. I like that. He must rise again from the dead. See, it's not just what Jesus did on the cross, paying for our sins, but he also died and he rose again from the dead. That's why we celebrate Easter. That is a big part of the gospel message. It says in Romans 10:9 that if you confess the Lord Jesus in your mouth and believe that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Sometimes in our sharing the gospel, we mention the cross, but we don't mention the resurrection. That's our great hope is the resurrection. Paul would talk about the power of the resurrection. And in Ephesians 1:19-20, when Paul is praying for the Ephesians, he says, I pray that you would understand the greatness of the power that is available, the very power that raised Jesus from the dead. We are allowed resurrection power in our lives through Jesus. And he says here that he must rise again. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, he will live. The resurrection is everything. The resurrection is where we get our hope. And so we see in verse 10, then the disciples went away again to their own homes. So right there, we see John believes, but no one else is saying that they believe yet. And even though some of them haven't seen Jesus yet, but now the Lord's going to turn things up. So now we see that they wondered, and now we're going to see that they are going to be wowed, if you will. Verse 11, but Mary stood outside by the tomb weeping. And as she wept in the tomb, she looked in the tomb and she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus lay. And they said to her, woman, why are you weeping? And she says, because they've taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him. And now she has said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there and did not know it was Jesus. Think about that. Saw Jesus standing there and did not know it was Jesus. How many people have been introduced to Jesus, seen the work of Jesus, heard the words of Jesus, but they don't know Jesus? It's amazing. It's a mystery to me. So many people, God is working all along. He's orchestrating things in their life. They're seeing him work in other people. They're seeing him do things. They're seeing him do kinds of great things, and they just don't know him. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, and they know me, and I know them, and I give them eternal life. That's part of our salvation experiences, is to know God, to know him personally, not just to get a free ticket to heaven. It's to know him intimately, personally. But it seems to be that right now, her eyes were hidden because Jesus said to her, woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? She, supposing him to be a gardener, said to him, sir, if you have carried away, tell me where you have laid him. And then it says, Jesus said, Mary, and she says, Rabboni. All of a sudden, she recognizes him. But a couple things I want to share here. It tells us in Mark 16:9 that Jesus first appeared to Mary Magdalene. He first appeared to Mary Magdalene. See, we think about all the guys, you know, the disciples, all the leaders, you know, and they're running like, you know, dogs with their tails between their legs. It says, strike the shepherd and the sheep will scatter, and they all scattered. The only one that was at the cross was John of the disciples, but Mary Magdalene was there. Mary Magdalene was there when they went to the tomb and laid Jesus in it. Mary Magdalene was there first at the tomb. Mary Magdalene, if you read her story, she had seven demons cast out of her, which reminds us, it does not matter what your past is. God can use you. God has a plan for every human being. I don't care what you've done. That's how great our God is. He doesn't look at your past. He looks at what you could become in the future. He doesn't define you by your failures. He defines you by your potential. I see greatness in you. And if you will believe in me, if you will not be unbelieving, but believing, you trust in and. One of our little slogans we put on our little sandwich board outside is a scripture, Psalm 34. It says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. Many of you are here because you have trusted in the Lord and you have seen that he's good. And you want more of the Lord. And he's going to give you more. But Mary is such an example. We also read in Luke chapter 8, verse 2 and 3, it talks about women followed Jesus around when he went around to the different cities preaching and teaching and healing, and they provided for him from their substance, like they supported his ministry. We read at the end of Matthew that she ministered to Jesus. So when I look at Jesus or look at Mary and I see that God, Jesus went to her first, I can't help but think, draw near to God and he'll draw near to you. You know, God is saying to Mary, you're awesome. Everybody else left, but you are there. You're the one I'm going to go to first, and you're the one that I'm going to send to the disciples. And the funny thing is, she goes to the disciples, and most of them don't believe it. But she got this special privilege, and I believe because she just had this passion for God, and God's like, I love the passion in this girl. And God can do that with anybody. But look at this in verse 15. Woman, woman, whom are you, or why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? I thought about that. Why are you weeping? She's weeping because she misses her Savior. But I saw this. How many? This could be a question to someone else. Why are you weeping? Why are you weeping? Why are you weeping? Why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? When we have a problem with weeping, sometimes the answer is in our seeking. When we're weeping, we need to be seeking the Lord. When we ask, why are we weeping? The answer isn't why, the answer is who. He says, whom are you seeking? The answer is always Jesus. When we're going through it, when we're going through tough things, the Bible says that God is near to those who are broken and those who are bowed down, and Jesus came to heal the brokenhearted. When we're weeping, when we're just crushed, when we're missing that person that's not with us anymore, or someone we care is ill, or this relationship is falling apart, seek the Lord. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon his name, and he will reveal himself to you. And so Mary was in the right place. And then in verse 17, Jesus said, do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father and my God and your God. What a powerful thing. My Father and your Father, my God and your God. When Jesus gave us the Lord's Prayer, first thing he says, okay, this is how you start off. Our Father in heaven. He didn't say my Father. He said our Father. We have the same Father as Jesus. Is that amazing? And when we pray to the Father in Jesus' name, he intercedes for us. But we have the same Father. But he says, do not cling to me. We read in one of the other Gospels that the women cling to him and they started to worship at his feet. And he sent them out to the disciples too. But all of a sudden, Mary is encouraged because she sees Jesus. Her weeping and her wondering all of a sudden is turning into worshiping. She's like, she's going to turn to worship because she sees the Lord. Then look at verse 19. Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, peace be with you. I love that. These guys are scared to death. You know, their champion, their hero, their Lord is like dead. And they're knowing, okay, we've been having these battles with the Jews all along and he's not here anymore. This is really going to get bad. So they're there together, meeting together. And what is the first thing Jesus do when he comes in there? Peace to you. Peace to you. And Jesus is reminding us that when we're scared, when we're fearful, you need the Lord. You know, the Bible often would say, fear not, for I am with you. It always couple these two thoughts. Don't fear because I am with you. Fear not, for I am with you. Fear not, I will be with you wherever you go. You see that quite a few times. And then it also says that he came and stood in the midst. You know, the Bible says when there's two or three gathered together in the name of Jesus, Jesus says, I am there in your midst. That's Jesus saying it. I am there in the midst when two or three gather together my name. And he says, peace to you, because he's the Prince of Peace. Amen? He's a Prince of Peace. And verse 20, when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Yeah, we should be glad when we see the Lord. Now, what's going to be interesting about the story, I'm going to kind of just mention it again at the end, is these disciples, they see the Lord. They physically, personally see the Lord. We don't see the Lord. I mean, we sing songs like, I see the Lord high and lifted up and all this stuff, but we have a relationship with the Lord, as you're going to see later through Thomas. It's not one what we see, it's what we believe. And as we believe, we see in the spiritual sense. We see the Lord, and we are glad We are glad because of what the Lord has done in our lives and who he is. But I like, and it says, peace be with you. I wanted to think about that because it says in Romans 5:1, it says, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. You want peace with God? It comes through Jesus. Because Jesus went on the cross to take away our sin, and he proved that he has the power of God and that he is God because he rose again from the dead. And he ascended into heaven, and he's sitting at the right hand of the Father right now, interceding and praying for us as we speak. And he's praying for those that don't know the Lord to come to the Lord. But we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, having been justified by faith. Justified by faith is another way of saying you've been saved. You've given your life to Jesus, and your sins are forgiven. Now you have peace with God because of what Jesus did. And he's telling them peace, and he's telling them glad. And then verse 2, guess what? Jesus said to them, again, peace to you. I don't know about you guys. I need to hear stuff again and again. I know Jesus loves me. I know we win in the end. I know he's with me. I know he'll never leave me or forsake me. He'll go with me. I need to hear it all the time. And I've told you guys this before. A lot of times I get woken up early in the morning and, you know, God's probably telling me to pray, but all of a sudden I'll start getting anxious thoughts. I'm like, get behind me, Satan. Not today. You know, I'm not taking the bait. And I'll go in and I'll open this thing right here and I'll read a promise of God and the peace returns. See, God wants us to be dependent upon him. God wants us to be in a daily relationship with him where we talk to him about everything. Jesus said men always ought to pray and not lose heart. Not sometimes, always. Why? So we don't lose heart. Paul talked about praying without ceasing. God desires a relationship where we're throughout the day just dialoguing with him, talking to him, listening to him, thinking about him, praising him, thanking him, whatever. Just having a relationship. And he says, so Jesus said to them, again, peace to you. I think I shared this verse last week. Psalm 119 says, 165 says, great peace have those who love your law, who love the Bible, and nothing shall cause them to stumble. We can have great peace if we love God's word, because God's word is full of so many promises. And that's what he's doing. But then he says, as the Father has sent me, I also send you. Now he's reminding these disciples of what their purpose in life was. Their purpose is to be sent. Their purpose is to live for God and to make him known. And our purpose is to make Jesus known, to share the gospel, and to make disciples. That's what Jesus called us to do. And Jesus often talked about the Father sent me, but then in John 17, he says, I send you. And now he's saying again, I send you. He didn't say stay, he said send. Now, send can have a lot of different meanings. You could be sent to another country. You could be sent to another neighborhood. But you could also be sent right where you're at. Did you know that? You're sent right where you're at. And this is the thing, is all of a sudden you realize, hey, I'm the light of the world now. Jesus said, I'm the light of the world. But he also said, while I'm in the world, I'm in the light of the world. Then you go into the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5, he says, you are the light of the world. He says, a city that's set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do you light a lamp and put it under a basket. You put it on a table so it gives light to everyone. And then he said, let your light so shine before men that they would see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. We are the light now. So we have been sent into our neighborhoods, into our families, into our jobs, into our schools, into our communities to let the light of Christ shine through us, that people would see that and we would get an opportunity to tell them about this wonderful Savior that we have. But this is their purpose and this is our purpose, to be sent, to be a light. And God's looking for people to be light. And then he says, receive the Holy Spirit. And he breathes the Holy Spirit on them. And he says, and if you forgive sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. That doesn't mean that they have the ability to forgive sins. That means they know the way to forgiveness through Christ. And they can say, hey, your sins can be forgiven because of what Jesus did. He is the way. And you are able to point people to Jesus. But now look at verse 24. Now Thomas, called the twin, one of the 12, was not with him when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said to him, we have seen the Lord. In other words, Thomas, you totally missed out, dude. You should have been there. You missed out. And then he says, unless I see in the hands the print of the nails and put my finger into the print of the nails, I put my hand into his side, I will not believe. Unless I see, I will not believe. Have you guys ever heard the phrase, seeing is believing? Well, in the spiritual realm, it's the other way around. Believing is seeing. When you start believing God and start taking him as word, I'm telling you, you're going to see stuff. You're going to see God work in miraculous ways. You're going to see sins that you could not get victory over. You're going to be able to get victory now. You're going to see relationships that you thought were done get healed. You're going to see a joy and a purpose and a meaning in your life that you didn't have before. You're going to see so many things happen when you believe. You know, and when you just think of the concept of belief, it's throughout the Bible. For God so loved the whole world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. Then he says, all things are possible to him who believes. Then he transfers that into prayer. When you pray, whatever you pray, believing, you will receive. Then he tells us it's impossible to please God without faith. For he who comes to God must believe that he is God, and he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. When you believe the things of God, you're a force that can't be reckoned with. You're a mighty man or woman of God. You're an influencer. You are a difference maker. You are an impact player. Seriously, when you believe this stuff and then allow God to start working in you, God's going to use every one of you. Everybody has the ability to be used by God if they want. But it's interesting, they said, we have seen the Lord. Kind of like you've missed out. Well, in a sense, he did. But God is so good for making it up. I just look at, and it really reminds me how important it is to be with the people of God. Just in this little passage between 19 and 23, this is what the disciples got that Thomas didn't get. Jesus was in their midst. He missed out on the presence of the Lord. Jesus said, peace with you. They missed the peace that these guys had. Verse 20 says, they were glad when they saw the Lord. He didn't have that gladness that they had because he didn't go with them. He wasn't with them. Jesus again said, peace to you. He missed out on a double portion of peace, if you will. Then he said, as a father has sent me, I also sent you. He missed directions from the Lord. He missed his purpose in life, that you were called to go. You were called to make. He didn't get that. And he didn't get the Holy Spirit breathed on him. When we miss out on fellowship, we miss out on so many good things. I don't know how many times. It was kind of funny. We were at the prayer breakfast yesterday. And I was with a couple guys. And each guy had a story about, you know, up late, couldn't get here. I didn't really want to come. And I felt I should come. And I said, yeah, I was thinking the same thing. And then I felt this little voice like, you're the pastor, dude. And I'm like, okay, Lord, okay, you're right. But I was so glad I came. I mean, way before I was a pastor, when I would go to the prayer breakfast or go to a meeting or go to something, I would say, why did I almost not go? I got so blessed. The enemy, the flesh, and the world are always going to try and talk you out of spiritual things. Because the enemy and the world knows, man, if this guy or this girl latches on to the great things of the Christian faith, they're going to make a big difference in the kingdom. And I hate that. I can't have that. So you're going to have all these little weird thoughts like, hey, man, just sleep in. Hey, watch the game today. You know what? You deserve it. You deserve a break today. You know, it's like, no, I need to go and be there with the people of God. So Thomas missed it. But guess what? Jesus comes to Thomas. And the first thing he says in verse 26, peace to you. And then he goes right to Thomas. I love it. He goes right to Thomas. Reach your finger here, look at my hands, and reach your hand here and put it in my side, and do not be unbelieving, but believing. He did the exact same things he did for the other disciples, because it says in verse 20 that when he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. He showed Thomas the same thing that he showed them. And some people will call, oh, Thomas, he's doubting Thomas. Actually, Thomas is kind of a thinker. He's kind of like analytical. You know, it's kind of like, let's say you go to buy something, you know, and nowadays, man, have you ever seen the contracts just to you just want to update something on your phone. Oh, you got to sign this. You got all these things like, we just like, you know, I don't got time for that. I'll just trust you. I'll just sign it. Thomas is like, I'm going to read this thing, but I'm going to know it. And that's just Thomas. It's like, fine, okay. But he would really think things through. He was called Doubting Thomas, but I don't think that's a good thing. Thomas should be known for great English muffins. Did you know that? When I was a kid, I used to love Thomas English muffins. I put them in the toaster. I put bread on it. And, Pastor, you're talking lunch now or breakfast. I know. But Thomas is a great guy. But he says, Do not be unbelieving, but believing. And this is what I think God wants to say to you and me. Do not be unbelieving. Be believing. Be believing. And then check this out. And Thomas answered and said, "My Lord and my God." Boy, you talk about a stamp of approval. You talk about going to the top of the class. My Lord and my God. None of the other disciples said that. Think about this, because I looked at this. The other three Gospels, it doesn't have any dialogue or any really words of the disciples in the other three books after the resurrection, except Jesus had this encounter with the two disciples on the Emmaus Road. And then the only other thing is what you see here in verse 25. We have seen the Lord. All the other words are Thomas's. And the last words he says, my Lord and my God. What a way to go. It's like Jesus, like, this is what I want you guys. You're making fun of Thomas because don't think of Thomas because he wasn't here. Think of what Thomas said. That's what I want you to remember about Thomas. And that was a good thing. My Lord and my God, because Jesus is God. This is a thing the world just can't wrap their mind around. That's the incarnation. When Jesus came to be a baby in the manger, that was God coming to man. And if you just look, if you look at the beginning, we're going to talk about it in a minute, because I'm going to have you turn to another passage. But Jesus, it says, was the Word, and the Word became flesh, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. But then he says, "Bless Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have seen and yet not believed." We have a more blessed faith than these disciples. I mean, that doesn't sound, that's kind of hard to wrap our minds around, but we have never seen Jesus. We're 2,000 years out, and we're following him. God says, that's awesome faith. That is a blessed faith. It's one faith. I mean, those guys were courageous. I mean, none of us will probably suffer a martyr's death like they did. Those guys were awesome. But Jesus is saying, you are more blessed if you have not even seen and you believe. You have not even seen and believe. And I want to go to this last point, the Word, in verse 30, 31. "And truly Jesus did many signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name." This is the reason that I picked John, one of the first books. I did that little four-book one on Haggai. You guys were here in the beginning, little impact history. The first four were out of Haggai, and the first message was the church is essential. Remember they were trying to tell us that we weren't essential? We're like, hello? You're not essential. I mean, seriously. The people that tell us the church isn't essential, they're not essential. The church is essential times a million. And so the first four, we did that. And then we did one day on Psalm 1. And I asked this question. Do you want to be blessed? Yes. I'm asking a question. Who wants to be blessed? Amen. There should be a few more hands. However, if you want to be blessed, read Psalm 1 and do it. It says, "Blessed is he who does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the path of the sinners, nor listen to the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord," the Bible. "He will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that will bring forth its fruit in its season and will not wither." Then it goes on to say, the ungodly are not so. They're like the chaff the wind blows away. But if you want to be blessed, you say no to the things of the world. You say yes to the things of the Lord. And you read and see in his face every day through his word. So we did it one day on that. And then I said, okay, we're going through the Gospel of John. You know why? Verse right there. "But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name." Amen. Amen. We went through this book. This is the one book that is given to new believers when they get saved. Most churches or crusades, they'll give them the Gospel of John. However, we don't just give the Gospel of John because they're a new believer. We give the Gospel of John to become a believer. When we were with Joe over there at Fairmont Park, you know, because sometimes we give out Bibles and sometimes New Testaments, and we talked to him. He said, let's just give him the Gospel of John. Let me tell you a story. John MacArthur, years ago, he was finishing up his day on a Friday, and he was getting ready to leave, and the secretary says, "Hey, John, there's a guy who wants to see you." He goes, "Well, I got to get going. I got to catch a plane, blah, blah, blah." He goes, "He just really sounds despondent. I know he doesn't have an appointment. Why don't you just meet with him for a couple minutes?" Goes, "Okay, bring him in." So he just sits down. This guy's bummed out, and he just has these questions, and he goes, "Hey, I got to get on a plane like in an hour, and I got to get on the road. But tell you what, read the Gospel of John. Here, you got a Bible? Yeah, read the Gospel of John. And next week, just make an appointment. My secretary will get you, and we'll talk. So he leaves. He doesn't see him all week. He sees him on Sunday. He goes, hey, weren't you the guy that came up to me? He goes, yeah. He goes, did you read the Gospel of John? He goes, yeah. He goes, what are your questions? He goes, I don't have any more. He goes, what do you mean? He goes, they're all answered. He goes, you know what? I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. I am so glad you gave me that book. Because in the Gospel of John, we have John 3:16. You're like, duh, Marty, I know that. But you know what I mean? That's the foundational verse we use. We also read that unless a man is born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. We also read that Jesus is the light of the world, and he who follows me will not walk in darkness, but have a light of life. We have those passages. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except by me. John 14:6. On and on and on. We have all those great promises about he's the door. And if we enter by him, we will be saved and go in and out and find pasture. That talks about salvation. And it talks about relationship. We find out that he is the vine and we are the branches. And if you abide in me, Jesus says, you will bear much fruit. And if your word abides in me, then you will ask what you desire and it will be given to you. And he says, I'm the bread of life. He who comes to me will never hunger. He who believes in me will never thirst. He meets our spiritual thirst, our spiritual hunger. And all throughout the Gospel of John, you have all these great passages that remind us of how much God loves us and that he sent his son, Jesus, the primary purpose. Jesus says, I came to seek and save that which is lost. Every human being is lost without Christ. Fact. We're all sinners. Fact. We've all done wrong things. And where the Bible says, it's appointed for men to die once, but after this, the judgment. But God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. So that's why we did this. So that's why we have some of these back there. These are Gospels of John. Pick a few up, hand them to somebody. Just say, hey, man, I'm not asking you to read the whole Bible, but just one book. Humor me. With prayer, of course. Humor me, you know, and then you just go to the throne of God. So just read this and let's talk. And the gospel's in it. So we have those back there. We also have these. Oh, so I'm not doing advertisements here. Here's that thing for the Bible. We also have Steps to Peace with God. This is the Billy Graham tract. It's like the most simplest breakdown of the gospel. Anybody can understand it. Even I can understand it. Why are you looking at me like I can't understand? I can understand it. I'm recommending it. But this is good stuff. Okay, so one thing I said a minute ago, one of the differences between us and all the disciples is they have the Lord's presence. We didn't. So I want you to turn to chapter 24 of Luke, and we're going to finish there. Because, okay, so what Jesus is trying to do is he's trying to get his disciples to not be unbelieving, but be believing. Okay? So go to Luke 24. Go to Luke 24. But I want to say this first. So first, Jesus is not at the tomb. That's supposed to get them to believe. Then he has angels at the tomb. That's supposed to get them to believe. Then he appears to Mary, and he appears to the women, and he appears to the two disciples on the Emmaus road to go tell the disciples, and that was to get them to believe. They still didn't believe. Then he shows up. They still didn't believe. Because if you look in Luke 24, 38, Jesus says, why are you troubled and why do doubts arise in your heart? Behold, my hands and my feet, it's I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see I had. And when they had said this, they showed him his hands and his feet. But while they still did not believe for joy and marveled, he said, you have any food here? It's kind of, okay, you're not believing the angels, you're not believing the empty tombs, you're not believing the girls, you're not believing the two disciples, you're not believing Mary Magdalene, who I appeared to first, by the way, not you guys. He goes, and then I show up and you're still not believing. And I show you the nail prints and you're still not believing. He goes, you got any food? So they give him a fish sandwich or something, you know, and he eats it. It's kind of like he's saying, I'm not a ghost, guys. I'm not a phantom, see? Touch me, I'm going to eat the food here, I'm doing everything. And yet they still didn't believe. Because if you go into the other gospels, you see that Jesus kind of rebuked their hardness of heart and lack of belief. But look here at earlier in verse 20, chapter 24. This is what I want to really say. In chapter 24, verses 13 to about 35, he meets the two disciples on the Emmaus Road. You guys, I'm sure you all know the story. He appears to the disciples, and there it says in verse 17, what kind of conversation is that you have with one another as you walk in are sad? And then one of them, whose name is Cleopas, says, are you the only stranger of Jerusalem, and have you not known the things that have happened here in these days? And I love this. People think Jesus doesn't have a sense of humor. He says, what things? I mean, what are you talking about? What things, you know? I think he's probably got a little smile on his face, like, what things, you know? And then he says, the things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our own rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we were hoping. Okay, these guys are sad without hope. Verse 21, but we were hoping that he was going to be to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all these, today is the third day. he's thinking, excuse me, third day? Did I talk about the third day quite a few? He actually did talk about the third day quite a few times. But notice what Jesus does with this conversation. Look at verse 25. O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded or explained to them all in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Did you catch that? Okay, so Jesus is now going to the scriptures. Guys, this is the stuff the Old Testament talks about. You know, me riding in on a donkey, you know, virgin birth, Isaiah, the Christmas story. But it also talks about what just happened. Isaiah 53, Psalm 22, Psalm 69, Psalm 16, all these things about me rising again from the dead. And it says he kind of gives them like a little history lesson. He says, at the Moses and all the prophets. That's kind of a way of just covering the whole Old Testament. Often Moses and the prophets, they would say that to cover the Old Testament. And it says he explained things to them concerning himself. Let me ask you a question. Do you want to be on fire for the Lord? Okay, all three of you. Praise the Lord, man. We are a mighty army here. These three guys are going for it. I'm serious, though. Do you want to be on fire for the Lord? Do you want to be zealous for the Lord? Amen. Do you want to have a heart that burns for the Lord?
Yes.
Okay. Look at verse 32. And they said to one another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us on the road and while he opened the scriptures to us? They got fired up because he shared verses in the Bible that talked about him. All the promises of God are in here, guys. Everything we need for a life of godliness is found through here. Now, let's go turn to verse 44. Now Jesus is with all the disciples. He's only with the two right there. Now he's with the whole group, the whole gang. The other gospel tells us he rebuked them for their hardness of heart and lack of belief because they didn't believe the two disciples. They didn't believe Mary. They didn't believe the women. They didn't believe the empty tomb. All that stuff. He didn't believe. But this is what he says in verse 44. These are the words which I spoke to you. He's reminding them. These are the words I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me. Here he is talking about the Old Testament again. First he was just talking to the two guys and they got fired up because he shared all the scriptures in the, it says Moses and the prophets. Now he's with the 11 and he's sharing with them the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me. And then he says, verse 45, and he opened their understanding that they might comprehend the scriptures. See, Jesus took them to the scriptures. We can't see Jesus, but you know what? We got the scriptures. They had the Old Testament. We got the Old Testament. We got the New Testament. We got the actual words of Jesus, the red letter edition. You know, then we got the Acts of the Apostles. We got the book of Revelation. We got so many great things that we can be encouraged with. Now, I want to show you something. Look at verse 45. See the word scriptures? Is that capitalized in your Bible? Okay, go back to verse 32. He opened the scriptures. Is that capitalized? Okay. Go look at verse 27. He expounded to them the things called in the scriptures. Is that capitalized? Yeah. You know what capitalization means often in the Bible? Especially with personal pronouns, it means deity. Like when you say he and it's a capital, that's talking about God or Jesus or the Holy Spirit. And you know what? Jesus is the Word of God. Look at the very next page. If you have a real Bible, it's going to say John 1 next to Luke 24. If it doesn't, get rid of that Bible. But look at the very beginning of John 1. In the beginning was the Word, capitalized, and the Word, capitalized, was with God, and the Word, capitalized, was God. Verse 14, and the Word, capitalized, became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And in the book of Revelation, chapter 19, Jesus is specifically called the Word of God. You want to know God? Right there. That's why you see me promoting this all the time. I've just seen it change my life. I've seen it change so many people's lives. I've seen it just impact so many people. And that's what the Bible tells us. The Word of God, the more you read this, the more you are going to know God. The more you're going to see who God is. And that's what Jesus left us with. He left us with the Holy Spirit, but he left us with the Bible. One last verse on belief. John chapter 14, verse 12 to 14. Jesus says, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do. And greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. That whatever you ask the Father in my name, that I will do it. Whatever you ask, I will do it. Jesus is saying, if you would just believe, you could do greater things than I did, which is pretty hard to fathom. But that's what the Word says. There have been great people but people that did great things because they had a great God. And they gave him the glory and they believed it. But notice, he also ties that in with prayer. Whatever you ask the Father in my name. And Jesus would say often, whatever you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive. That's why we're big on prayer here. I'm just giving you a little heads up. Next week, at the end, we're going to break up in groups and pray. I hope someone says, I'm not coming next week. No. I'm going to pray for you guys right now. But next week, we're going to stop a little early and we're going to pray. Because I believe God wants us to be a praying people, because we call on the name of the Lord and we get his power. We get his wisdom. We get his direction. We get his protection. We get all of that. That's why we're big on prayer at this church. Because we're a bunch of sinners saved by grace, guys. You know that? Every one of us. None of us is any better than anybody else. But you know what? We have an awesome God. We have an awesome Savior. So what I want to do is we're going to pray. And I'm going to give an opportunity for anybody to receive Christ. I'm going to just share the gospel real quick. And then I want to pray for us all, whoever wants to be prayed for God to pour out his Holy Spirit on us. So close your eyes, please. Father, I thank you for these people. And Lord, your word says, as we've been going through the Gospel of John, we are all sinners, and our sin separates us from God. The Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and it's appointed for men to die once, and after this, the judgment. But Jesus, you came. You told us that the wages of sin is death. That's the bad news. But the good news is we can have eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The Bible says, as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name. All we need to do to have a relationship with God is to ask for his forgiveness, to turn from our sin, to believe he died on the cross for our sin and that he rose again from the dead, and just promise to follow him all the days of my life. And if that's you, I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that. You're asking Christ to be your Lord, to be your Savior, to forgive you of your sin, that you would have that guilt taken away, that you would have that hope of heaven and that relationship with God. So if that's you, just repeat this after me out loud or in your heart. Dear Heavenly Father, forgive me of my sin. I am sorry for what I've done. But I believe in you. I believe you died on the cross for my sin. And I believe you rose again from the dead. And I want to follow you all the days of my life. Be my Lord and Savior. Forgive me of my sin. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and help me to follow you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, we have some Bibles back there. We have some people that love to pray with you, answer any questions you have, even get you plugged in the church. But I want to pray right now. Let me just share this verse. Are you guys still in Luke 24? No, Pastor Marty, I closed the Bible. Okay, then I'm just going to share really quick. After all these things that Jesus said, this was the very next thing he said. He says it was necessary for Christ to suffer. Remember we said he must rise again? It was necessary. Why? For Christ to suffer and rise from the dead the third day, that repentance and forgiveness of sins would be preached in his name to all nations beginning in Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things. Guess what? You're witnesses of these things. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but wait in the city of Jerusalem until you endued with power from on high. And this is what happened at Pentecost in Acts chapter 1. It says, you will be witnesses when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and he will empower you to be witnesses to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world. So we're going to pray. I'm going to pray. And if you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, you want the Holy Spirit power. This isn't to go out and be weird like you see some of these so-called people on TV. This is to be a witness. This is to have the boldness to share the gospel message, to live for Christ, to have a witness that's going to make a difference, and to receive the gifts that God has for you so you can be used by him. So I'm going to close my eyes. Everyone close their eyes. I don't want people looking around. I'm going to pray. If you want me to pray that and you want to receive Christ in your heart, you want to receive the power of the Holy Spirit, you want to be a witness, you want to make difference for the Lord Jesus, raise your hand right now. No one's looking at you. I'm not looking at you. But I got my hand raised up because I want a filling. I want a fresh filling of the Holy Spirit. And Lord, you said do not be unbelieving, but be believing. Those of us that want to be used by you, we believe in you. We believe in the power of the Holy Spirit. We're raising our hand right now. We're saying, Lord, I can't do this on my own. I try to share the gospel with people. I just kind of clam up. Lord, I don't feel like I know enough. Lord, I just get antsy. I just get fearful. Lord, the disciples prayed for boldness in chapter 4. And it says that the place where there was shaken and they were filled with the Holy Spirit and they went and spoke the word of God with boldness. So Lord, as you see those hands raised up right now, Lord, we are saying we want to be used by you. We need your power in our life to live the Christian life. We are done with compromise. We don't want to go to the left or to the right. We want to go right down the middle of that path that God has for us. We want to be men and women that are yours. You told us that we are your property. We have been bought with a price, and we're to glorify you with our body and our spirit. So, Lord, I pray right now for all of us to have our hand raised up. You would fill us to overflowing with your Holy Spirit. Lord, not only would we be witnesses, but we would have the fruit of the Spirit, love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and faithfulness and self-control, as it tells us in Galatians 5, 22 and 23. We want to be used by you. So Lord, fill us, use us, and send us out for your glory. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, guys, let's stand up and worship.
Song that calms the storm inside of me. Let it ride.
This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God.
One more time, sing it again.
We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, 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 oh. We praise you. Oh,
just real quickly, if you want some prayer at the cross, we're going to have Dustin and Emily over there willing to pray for you. Let me just pray a blessing on you, and then you guys are dismissed. Lord, I pray for these people. I pray that you bless them, that you be with them, that you do great, wonderful, mighty, powerful things in their life for your glory, Lord, that you bless their going out and their coming in, Lord, that you protect their family, Lord. You give them wisdom with any decisions they're making, Lord. May the joy of the Lord be their strength, Lord. Just be with them and bless them this day. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys.